Hello and welcome. We are in Gold Coast, Australia, where I am getting browner by the second. I'm going to come back a full right Hispanic because it is so hot here. What's going on, man? Can you turn it down?
No, mate. It's what we get in Australia, and it's the middle of summer here. Well, the end of summer, and the end of summer is always the hottest part of the year. The good thing is the kids go back to school,
right?
And all they get in the first week and the second week of school is nice 40 degree, 45 degree day, which is about 105 or 110 for those of you who still use Fahrenheit.
I haven't introduced you yet, but all I know is that literally I showed Golnaz, our producer, a map, and they had to come up with a new color for the temperatures that it was going to be in Australia, is that right?
Yep. Basically, they've gone to purple, which is worse than red.
I think, the color of my boss, Larry, who decided to not wear sunscreen. That was a burn. Two times. All right. So I'm here with Orin Thomas, and I'm going to read this bio because, like, I feel like I haven't done anything in life after I read this. I'm here with Orin Thomas, who is an MVP and a Microsoft Regional Director, an MCT and has a string of Microsoft MCSEs and MCITP certifications. He has written more than 36 books, which is more than I have read. More than 36 books for Microsoft Press on topics including Windows Server, Windows Client, Azure, System Center, Exchange Server, How to Solve Cancer, and SQL Server. I added that one in there. It's not true. He is the author of Pluralsight as a candidate in the Doctor of Information Technology program at Charles Sturt University.
Yes.
So I have to call you doctor soon. How soon?
Probably about 2 years.
So 2 years.
It's a fairly new program. There's a couple of them around the world. It's a professional doctorate in information technology. So rather than just a PhD, which is purely research on an academic topic, It's research on an information technology-based topic.
Oh, that's awesome.
And in my case, I'm very interested in cloud compliance and security. So I'm actually writing on cloud compliance and security.
Okay. So we have some time. I have here Adam, who's just staring at me, eating his... Did you want to come sit down with us? Oh, no, you're okay. Okay, he's okay. I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of the intersection, because you have books on tons of stuff, but there's this interesting intersection that's happening, and you brought it up a little bit, between what happens with developers, what happens with IT pros, and what the cloud is doing with all of that. So why don't you give us sort of an overview from your perspective of what this all means, the cloud for IT pros and developers?
Well, there's a couple of interesting things about the intersection of IT pros and developers. One of the ones I find most fascinating is this idea that the average IT pro is in their early to mid 40s, And the average developer is in their early to mid 20s. So in a couple of years, we're actually going to be at the stage where the average developer is the age of the average IT pro's children. So that's going to certainly put the relationship in a very different way. It's certainly going to definitely be, you're not the boss of me.
So if I'm understanding this correct, the average age of the developer is going to be the average age of the IT pro's kid.
Yeah.
That's like a weird dynamic.
It is. It's already a fraught dynamic between the two, because developers, they want to get it out there. They want to do it. It's about the act of raw creation.
Sure.
Whereas an IT pro is the act of, I need this to work reliably. I've got to make sure it meets all of these legislative requirements. It's got to keep running. Whereas the developer's out there creating art.
Sure, yeah.
To an extent. I might be extending it a little
bit. Right.
But this is the idea. And so you've always had this tension between IT pros and developers. And the cloud assists with that in some ways, but in some ways it also doesn't go away. Because one of the interesting things that an IT pro, when they approach the cloud, they're like, okay, how do we ensure that services, that infrastructure that we built on premises is replicated and available in the cloud? That all of those bits and pieces that need to be there for a developer to do their job are still going to be there in the cloud.
I see. So would you consider yourself more an IT pro, a dev? Or are you a renaissance man of both skills?
I'm definitely from the IT pro side of things, but it's very much today that you can't be just one. You need to be able to cross that. But I'm trying to approach from the side of, I'm an IT pro, and I'm explaining to developers why IT pros are still relevant and still important.
Of course.
Because developers can get so caught up in the process of development that they forget some of those important fundamentals. And we saw that last week with a particular startup which who in theory had six different types of technology backing up their servers. But when it came down to it, the reliability wasn't there. And an IT pro is the person that's responsible for doing all of that boring administrivia.
Right.
And I think that that's, when IT pros have got to think about their role in talking to developers, it's about, okay, yes, we're here to support you, but we're here to provide you with not only the infrastructure support which we gave in the past, but also advising on things like compliance and policy. Like, you've got data here, and this data has all of this regulation around it. And we understand, you know, we'll go out and learn all the boring stuff so that you can get on with the pure act of creation.
So before, as an IT pro, and every, whenever you're like a one-person shop, let's just say Sue, right? She used to get a box of CDs, and then she would have to install it on this machine and then get the application to work. That was, to me, what IT pro work is. But no one's getting a box of CDs anymore.
No.
So what would be, like, for an IT pro that's worried a little bit about, holy cow, what am I going to do now that I don't do that? What does an IT pro job look like now, and how has a developer's job sort of changed to help that?
So one of the terms I heard recently from Don Jones was this idea of the infrastructure developer.
Okay.
So an IT pro becomes a developer of infrastructure. So we hear of DevOps, and that also puts dev at the front and then ops there, and then IT pros kind of might even not like the taste of that because it feels like it's so developer-focused.
Right.
But if you talk about it in terms of, no, as an IT pro, your role is that infrastructure may have moved from physical devices to code, but it's that idea of infrastructure as code, that you've got to go and build the code that goes out and builds the routing infrastructure, that goes out and builds the VPNs, that goes out and builds the glue for the authentication infrastructure, that goes and does the backups, that goes and ensures that the configuration of the virtual machines. So as an IT pro, you're building infrastructure, you're just using a different set of tools to do it.
I see.
The responsibilities are the same. It's the tools that you use to do it have changed.
I see. So let's talk a little bit about those tools, because traditionally, if you had a really large scale application, you'd create this web farm, you'd set up IIS or whatever it was that we're using, it'd have to talk to each other, it'd be a load balancer. What does that look like now? Is it the same except all virtualized? Why don't you go through that process with us?
Well, it depends on obviously the platform you're using, but if you're using Azure, a lot of it, you can, when you start off using Azure, obviously, you're interacting with a console and you're figuring out things that way. But once you do that enough, what you see is there's a whole lot of templates that you can start to use.
I see.
Now, as an IT pro, you will then get used to finding the best tool to work with those templates. It might be Visual Studio. It might be just a straight text editor. But what you're seeing as an IT pro is you're still dealing with the same stuff. You're still dealing with, I've got this subnet and that subnet, and these need to be isolated. Whether that's running in Azure IaaS or it's running on-prem, you need to know how to put that together. So the toolkit you're using is far more that you're looking at the configuration as templates and modifying the templates rather than necessarily just going straight through a wizard.
So let's talk about sort of, I understand sort of the IT pro, but let's just say you're moving to a PaaS type situation. There's still a need for IT pros. There's still a need for defining infrastructure. Tell us about the role of the IT pro there.
Okay, so one of the important things to understand about PaaS is PaaS doesn't infantile. I mean, to an extent, it kind of says to the developer, we'll do all of the back-end stuff. But that's not the entire reality. If you go and deploy an application on PaaS, you still need to think about things like high availability. You need to think about how is the application being backed up. You've got to think about what are the limitations of that PaaS infrastructure. Because when you're assigning resources, you're saying, okay, I want to allocate it this amount of RAM. I want to allocate it this amount of processor. And that has a direct impact on the amount that you're paying.
I see.
So the IT pro is, again, the developer's going out in there and saying, I want to deploy my app. And then the IT pro is saying, okay, these are the constraints you're under. Just don't believe your cloud provider who says, deploy your app with us and everything's looked after. Because there's certain things that you need to look after. And it's the IT pro's responsibility to understand that line of demarcation between what the cloud provider's providing and what the organization that uses the cloud is providing.
And that's interesting because now we're looking at a situation where you have to manage your infrastructure in such a way that it doesn't cost more than it has to.
Yes.
And that's interesting because the dev just wants it to run, and let's just scale it all the way up, but then you might be using thousands of dollars where you could be using hundreds of dollars.
Exactly. And so that's where the role of the IT pro is in the cloud. Because the IT pro still is interested about those bits of administrivia, about how do I make sure that we're doing this in the most efficient manner. Because, yeah, a dev will sit there and they'll go, I want this to run fast. And they go, I know, let's just throw a G-series VM at it.
Right.
And that's really good until you get the bill at the end. So
not only that, but there's 1,000 visitors that month, which really didn't even do anything.
Exactly.
To the server. So it feels like the cloud is free as in, like the computation is free as in puppies are free, right? You get a free puppy, but it's not really free. There's still some work involved. Tell me about the day-to-day work of an IT pro managing this puppy in the cloud.
Okay, so the things are that an IT pro has to be aware of whether or not the application is properly sized and it's in its proper location. So for example, in PaaS, that means literally, is it doing the right thing? Then there's things like worker processes or Azure functions, where an IT pro has to make sure that all of that back-end maintenance that the application might have, there might be log files that are generated. How are they getting looked after? Who's looking at the log files? Is anybody looking at the log files? What about the security? Is the security set up, for example, to give an example, is Troy Hump talks about where he's running Have I Been Pwned?
Right.
And he went and put Cloudflare in front of his Have I Been Pwned, simply because when he did that, it offloaded a whole lot of stuff that was costing him money in Azure to Cloudflare, where Cloudflare was going, oh, this is clearly an attack. You shouldn't have to pay for that. Let's drop that traffic before it gets to Azure. So it's about, to an extent, the IT pro understanding the architecture of the application once it's there, and then perhaps making suggestions about its improvement and saying, look, the way that you've got this works, because that's a developer's, you know, what a developer wants to do. They want to get it there, they want to get it working. It's almost to an IT pro to sort of be there to tune the infrastructure to make sure that the application is functioning, performing as efficiently as possible.
Right.
And that might not be the interest of the developer, because the developer wants to move on to new things and new features rather than going in and looking at that maintenance of the application on an ongoing basis. Because, you know, you don't just release the puppy, right? You've got to look through, you've got the puppy for its life cycle.
It'll pee on your sofa. I'm not kidding. You got to make sure that you know where it is all times. So let's talk a little bit about, because I've noticed that developers, and now with the ease with which we have to sort of deploy things, you might have an organization of a couple, let's say 20 developers. They're pushing up prototypes on your Azure account all over the place. I'm sure there's just a mess of stuff sometimes that you need to clean up. How does someone look after that in Azure?
Well, that's where it becomes very interesting, because you literally have had organizations where the developers have gone wild and thrown stuff up, and they've not had someone come in and provide the adult supervision and going, okay, you know, you've gone and deployed this and never used it again. I mean, there's a stat that 30% of all virtual machines running in data centers are from abandoned projects.
Right.
And the same sort of stat applies with the cloud. So one of the things that I think we're going to see in future is we're going to see more IT pros say, okay, we've got something like Azure Stack. Let's do our development on premises so that if you are leaving stuff there, if you're orphaning workloads, we're not paying for that in the same way that if you've got an orphaned workload that's sitting in Azure accruing Azure credits. So of course, from Microsoft's perspective, Microsoft wants the best for their customers.
Sure.
But if they're making money every time someone goes and leaves a VM running in Azure that they don't need. It's the IT pro's job. And it's, you know, it's that part of the role.
Right.
To go in and say, okay, this is an orphaned workload. I'm going to go and do something about this. Because someone has to take responsibility for that.
Right. By the way, sorry to interrupt. We are live, and so if you do have questions, and I have some coming in, please ask them, because this is, in 2 years, the doctor of IT is what we're going to call him, Dr. It. Wait, that sounds like a horror movie, my
friend.
It
does, or something out of the Addams Family.
That's right. So you were saying it's the IT pro's responsibility to make sure that your Azure stuff is clean, right?
Well, yes, that you're not keeping stuff there that doesn't need to be there. Because one of the other things about security problems is that often when we're looking at security problems, it's because someone's gone and put something somewhere and forgotten about it.
Yeah.
And your attackers they go, okay, I've gone and found that the equivalent of an abandoned house. I'm going to go and move in there, and then I'm going to use that as my platform to then attack the rest of your infrastructure. Because if you've got something that no one's looking at, that's always going to be a point of entry. That's where, you know, if you're going to attack someone's infrastructure, you're looking for the thing that they're not looking at.
Got it. So here's a question from Keith. Soon, what IT pros provided will be addressed by platforms. Look at managed disk platform provided last week. I don't know what he said. Maybe he's telling us something about.
Well, so there is a belief, and one of the great wishes of developers is to get rid of IT pros entirely, right? Yeah. I mean, not that that's how it's necessarily expressed, but there's certainly the perception within the IT pro community that we can get rid of IT pros. We don't need you. We don't, you know, and again, it comes back to that dynamic I was talking about the parent and the child, right? Mm-hmm. I don't need you, you're not the boss of me. Because IT pros have always been in putting constraints on developers and saying, look, we can't do that. That's going to break the law. You're not backing it up, and so on and so forth.
Right.
But the reality is that just because you're moving to a new platform doesn't obviate the need for an IT pro, just as it doesn't obviously obviate the need for the developers. That act of creation needs to take place, but that act of curation, which is what an IT pro does, is also still necessary.
So let's talk a little bit about the tools. We have about 20 minutes, and I want to make sure that we get into some of the tools that you suggest. As an IT pro, how do you, in Azure, and you've written books about this, how do you manage this? Like, how do you know what your organization is paying for? How do you know what you shouldn't be paying for? Are there tools that Azure gives you to do that? What do you think?
So, for example, there's a lot, especially around OMS. So OMS gives you a good monitoring.
Now remember, I'm a dev, so you got to say OMS is, and this is just for me.
Operations Management Suite.
What does that do?
Well, it's sort of like System Center Operations Manager in the cloud. What it does is it allows you to go in and look at how your cloud deployment is functioning. And there's also management packs for System Center Operations Manager. But what you want to do is you want to have that granular understanding of how things are working in the cloud. It's not just a matter of looking at your billing statement and going, well, this resource was being used at this level. It's about understanding which resources are being used, which resources aren't.
Okay. And I know that Azure, because we get emails, the Channel 9 runs on Azure. Every once in a while, I get emails from Azure that says, you're not really using this. Do you want to get rid of it? Is Azure taking some of the responsibility of making sure you're optimally using it? Are you aware of anything like that?
I'm not as aware of that. I mean, the thing is that's a nice nudge, but you shouldn't be getting those nudges because it would be like, you know, your mum reminding you to tidy up your room.
Yeah.
It's a matter of your room should already be tidy. You should have a process in place, and you've still got to then go and investigate that and you say, okay, is that a reasonable observation on the part of Azure, or is this simply something where, no, actually we are using it properly? And that's what you've got to know. You've got to know how to ask the question and how to answer the question. If someone says, are you using your Azure subscription properly, can you answer that question? If the answer's no, then really what do you do? Because I think a lot of people get that thing and they go, I don't know.
Which is probably the more common answer.
Yeah, and about when it comes to educating yourself, I mean, there's so much to know. And this is the other thing. It's very easy to say we don't need a particular branch of knowledge anymore, but the reality is that there is so much to know about this technology that no one's going to be across the whole thing anyway.
Right.
And it's going to take a lifetime of understanding what you need to know what you need to know.
Sure. So let's talk a little about, you mentioned OMS as a tool for understanding what's out there. Is that something that you turn on in Azure? I mean, forgive my ignorance, help me out.
No, so it's another service within Azure.
Okay.
So that you can basically spin it up. It's something else that you pay for, and you can do a whole lot of things with OMS. It can also integrate with your on-premises infrastructure as well. So you're not just going and looking at Azure. One of the really cool things that was shown at a recent conference was how you could use OMS to monitor your virtual machines. And we're not just talking your Windows virtual machines,
right,
but your Linux virtual machines. Because one of the big challenges is when you're running a heterogeneous environment in the cloud, are you ensuring that you're keeping them up to date? Because this is one of the things that people forget when they go and deploy, say, an IaaS virtual machine, is that they think, oh, well, it's running in Azure. surely someone's patching it. No, the moment you spin up that VM, it becomes
it's yours.
It's your puppy, right? So you've got to feed it, you've got to care for it. And knowing what you're going to do, not only with your Windows virtual machines, but your Linux virtual machines or your BSD virtual machines, that's something that something like OMS can give you insights into.
So as a dev, every time I think of spinning up a virtual machine, I think, why would I do that? Why wouldn't I always just do a PaaS type thing? And so can you explain to me, as a dev, and I've just been a dev for like 20 years, why would I ever go the virtual machine infrastructure route, which would require more effort on my part, versus the PaaS route? There's got to be a reason.
Yeah, so there is. There's a couple. There's architectural. So one of the things, and I'll have to check, there's a limitation on the size of the database that you can have in Azure SQL.
Oh, I see.
So you can go out and shard it, you can go and do it in this way and that way. But when you've got an on-prem deployment, well, you can basically have, you've got a lot more, in a way, a lot more control over it. So one of the things that Platform as a Service does is it says, okay, we're going to run SQL for you, but we're going to run it sort of in our way. And that's a very sensible way of doing it, but sometimes you need to do something slightly different with SQL.
Sure.
So there are instances. Another instance might be, for example, you might have a configured replication between Azure SQL and a SQL Server instance. And you might say, right, we want our developers, when they're just testing stuff, to be hitting a SQL box. And when we're happy with it, we might then replicate that data up to Azure SQL.
I see.
It might be that you want to have certain data read from the cloud, or you might even have certain data that you need to keep separate from the cloud. So it's about, for example, controlling who can have access. And it might be a matter of you saying, okay, look, we want to run this in this geo, but for compliance reasons, we've got to keep other data in another geo. So we keep it in a VM and we keep it in, say, the Melbourne data center. But then we might have other data that we're happy to have out in US West or Europe.
I see. So, okay. So there might be compliance reasons. There might be just, for example, if someone did a lift and shift, it's easier to just go to VM
yeah,
route.
Yeah, exactly.
There's always a reason. So you should never discount anything.
No. And it's like, there's no one's forcing you to throw away tools that you've already got. And that's
right.
The important thing to understand is you find the best tool for the job. If the best tool for the job just happens to be Azure SQL, go and use that. If the best tool for the job is running a VM, because you might have an application that has that you want to bolt stuff onto, and it might simply be easier to have that on the same virtual machine.
I see. So let's talk a little bit about, as an IT pro, let's just say you're old school IT pro, and your organization is starting to feel the need to move to a cloud-based type thing. What are some things as an IT pro that you would start to learn or start to suggest that an IT pro learn
okay,
in order to make this shift?
Well, the easiest part way for an IT pro to get into Azure or any other cloud provider, but obviously we Microsoft, so
sure.
We're talking Azure, is to start putting workloads on IaaS VMs. So I used to do a talk here a couple of years ago, which was basically run a Minecraft server in Azure. Because what that could show an IT pro was a very simple workload that was easy to understand, that had some dependencies, and they could go and run it in Azure.
And you did a talk like this last night, roughly.
Yes, so I did Minecraft in containers.
I see.
Because the idea is, again, Minecraft is a really good sort of an exemplar workload, especially because it's got
it's
a Java
contained.
Dependency, but it's got a Java dependency, so it's got a third-party dependency. It's a kind of a third-party application. It's got all of the networking that you need to do, so it's a networked application. You've got all of that. So it's a great descriptive application. That's why I did it with containers as well, because suddenly people can see, oh, I can spin up all these containers as Minecraft servers, or in the past, I can spin up a VM with Minecraft, and suddenly, for a lot of people, that makes sense, because suddenly they're making that analog between their on-prem data center and what Azure does, and they're going, oh, I understand that.
Awesome. So we started to talk a little bit about what you need to know as an IT pro, and you started down the road of Minecraft. So is that thing, just get something and put it up there?
Yes, go and explore. So one of the things that Azure does is that you can go and get trial subscriptions. Have a project, go and put it there. You learn by doing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'd recommend going and looking at Pluralsight, reading my books and so on and so forth, but that's just consuming information. You've got to utilize it. Because it's when you're utilizing it, you're starting to understand, okay, we've got this problem on-prem, I can think about how to solve that in the cloud. And then maybe it makes sense to do that, or maybe it doesn't make sense to do that. And you've got to have that understanding, because there are certainly some workloads where it doesn't make sense to put it in the cloud. And it's not just compliance. You might have some insane virtual machine requirements where the processing requirement is there 24/7 over an insanely extended period.
I see.
So in that case, it might not make sense to go and put it in the cloud, simply because your billing over the course of a year might be more expensive than buying the hardware and putting it in. But if you only need that processing requirement over a very short amount of time, then it makes much more sense to go and put it in the cloud, because you're only paying for what you use and you're only using it sort of intermittently.
Let's talk a little bit about sort of the hybrid approach, because let's just say you need to have stuff on-prem, but you like the way Azure works. Talk a little bit about Azure Stack and how that facilitates that scenario.
So Azure Stack, for those of you that don't know, is basically gives you the ability to deploy an on-premises version of Azure. So it's just sort of like your own geo in your own data center. So it's still, I believe, in preview. And I believe the lead architect's Jeffrey Snover. But the idea is with Azure Stack that you can have your on-prem data center, basically, or part of your on-prem data center running Azure, so that you can then go and prototype your workloads, you can get things working on-prem, and then should you need to, that can be connected out to Azure. So as you want to make resources public, or as you want to go out and put more computational power than what you've got in your data center, you can go and leverage Azure, and you can move workloads in and out as necessary.
That's interesting. So I've always been curious about this, because do I have to buy a certain kind of machine, or do I have to have a certain kind of rack, or do I just install? Like, I'm wondering, am I getting a box of CDs and a big box, or what's going
on?
So
at the moment, I believe that the plan is that basically you will go to certain OEMs like Lenovo or Dell or HP, and that you will actually buy an Azure Stack.
And it's provisioned.
And it's going to be, you can certainly go and get a test version and build your own test version, but it's going to be completely unsupported.
Right.
The idea is that way, to an extent, Azure Stack is going to be a bit of a black box, in that you don't necessarily see inside it the way that you would if you were building out your own virtual machine manager infrastructure. And this is scary to a lot of IT pros, because they're like, well, we're used to going in and we're used to fiddling with those bits. But to an extent, your responsibilities are sort of moving up the stack a little with Azure Stack, because your requirement to back things up to make sure that they're running, that's still there. It's
right.
Again, just the tools that you're applying that knowledge to. The canvas has changed.
Awesome. By the way, we're taking questions live. If you have any questions, feel free to submit them using the hashtag, and I'm going to get it right this time, is MSAU Ignite, hashtag, I'm watching that, or you can put questions on the channel line question box just below. So we have about probably 5-10 minutes. My question for you is, what are the exciting things as an IT pro that the cloud has created for you?
I think that the thing that's been most interesting is simply the ability to deploy certain types of infrastructure very quickly. Now, I have very powerful hardware, but sometimes it's very quick to go and just, if I need to go and check something very quick, it's easier for me to go and deploy a VM from the gallery and do it that way and then blow it away than it is necessarily to go out and build a lab in my own environment and test it that way.
I see.
So that's one of the things. One of the other things I really like is I like the Azure ADDS, which is where you can turn on Azure AD and it projects into a subnet, and then you can domain join virtual machines. And I actually used that in solving a problem for a client recently where they wanted to run certain software that required, and they had all of their accounts sitting in Azure AD, and they were like, how do we get those accounts, how can we create an account in Azure AD and then have that usable in a virtual machine? And I go, well, actually you can go and do it this way, so that you can create an account in Azure AD and then they can RDP across to a virtual machine, and then they can perform a task, and the accounts are controlled by Azure AD.
Interesting.
Rather than you spinning up a domain controller in a cloud and managing it that way.
And that's interesting, because like, I would have never thought of that, because I don't, like, anytime someone's like, hey, I'm gonna make Active Directory work, it was like a week's of work, and then I had to log in, and then things happened in magic and unicorns and rainbows. But with the knowledge that you have as an IT pro, you're enabled to sort of shift that into the cloud.
Yeah, and that's the other difference, is that IT pros have a giant domain of knowledge about how to solve problems in a different way. And sometimes you need to look at a problem from a variety of different ways. Whereas you might be butting your head against something as a developer simply because you're unaware that a technology exists. And for an IT pro, if you're going to, you know, if you're looking after your career, what you need to do is you need to go in and you need to understand what is available.
Right.
So that when someone comes to you and says, can we do that? Your answer isn't, I don't know, or it's not no when it should be yes. It's merely that you actually understand what options are on the table.
Yeah, and that's, see, and for a dev, there's certain things I'm just not going to know about that I need to ask my IT pro. Like, we were going to do this gag where we put him in a Rick hat and his glasses, because apparently you can double as Rick. Every once in a while, I'm like, hey, Rick, I don't know what this means. And he's like, oh, geez. And he comes and tells me.
Yeah.
Like, he's my dad. Yeah, I'm looking at you, Rick. But anyway.
We love you, Rick.
Yes, we do. But it's actually super helpful to have this wealth of knowledge. And because I feel like a lot of IT pros are like, is my knowledge going to transfer? And you say it does.
Yeah, so the trick is to understand that certain knowledge expires, but certain knowledge remains relevant. For example, if you learnt TCP/IP addressing 20 years ago, that's still relevant. And this is, again, where I came down to this idea about the age difference. So one of the things with developers, the developers are always working on the newest technology, which means that they're really expert on, often on the new and the flash. Mm-hmm. Whereas IT pros have worked over a succession of technologies historically. And to an extent, because they've got that experience, you know, wisdom comes from experience and experience comes from a lack of wisdom.
Right.
It's a matter of that they can go, well, actually, we can go back and use this technique that we might have used because I've seen this problem before in a different context.
So to finish up here, a question from a viewer, Golnaz, where can we get the best surf and turf in the Gold Coast? Someone has already checked out, apparently.
So I've heard, I think it's called Moomoo's.
Moomoo's.
I think it's called Moomoo's.
Appropriate for the turf part. So Moomoo's.
I believe so, but I'll double check that for you.
And the another question, I started with it, super hot. Is this the hottest it's ever been here?
So I believe the record for Australia is actually up somewhere around 49. We've certainly had 47 in Melbourne. So 47 is about somewhere between 105 and 110. But there's some nice videos on the internet of some cops out somewhere in the outback. They just get a frying pan, they put it on the front of their cop car, and they break an egg and fry an egg because it's so hot.
The old fry an egg on your car trick works every time. Well, Orin, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Coming up next, we have the great Donna Sarkar with a special guest. Make sure to stay tuned. We are taking your questions. So if you are a Windows insider, please ask her when the next build is going to come out. I'm sure she will say sometime soon. All right, we'll catch you after the break. Thanks for being with us.